Now, we continue our look at generational tensions in our country over economic disparities. The COVID-19 shutdown and recession may have exacerbated an already growing division in popular culture between millennials and baby boomers. Tonight, we hear from that older generation and from our own economics correspondent, Paul Solman.
No matter what you actually accomplish or feel like you accomplish, you don't feel like you're actually moving forward in life. It's like
the millennials lament. We heard it last night from a group of millennials.
2020 came, still had no income. So we were living with my parents.
I still feel like I'm behind the eight ball.
And the pandemic has only made economic matters worse, even for our group of college grads, a group hit much less hard than those without higher degrees.
Renting is basically all I kind of see for my wife and I for the foreseeable future.
This one goes out to all the 65-plus crowd on SoundCloud.
So who to blame? More and more these days, it's okay, boomer.
Okay, boomer, okay, boomer, okay, boomer, okay, boomer.
That is the baby boom, roughly those of us born between the end of World War II and 1964, is fingered as the culprit. So tonight, we give my generation the right of reply.
Beating up on baby boomers, it's sort of the last acceptable prejudice.
Professor Lenny Steinhorn wrote The Greater Generation in Defense of the Baby Boom Legacy 15 years ago, when blame was already being assigned.
You know, you see all of these essays and all of these articles and all of these people going on TV criticizing baby boomers as if they're somehow singularly selfish or narcissistic or the me generation and all of that. And so I wanted to be able to correct the record, correct the history, and put it in historical context.
Part of the context, says Steinhorn, 65, is pure luck, growing up in a booming economy, as a group of boomer panelists we assembled happily did. Like Joe Ferreira, 56, a high school history teacher in Massachusetts.
When I left school, I had no debt on my shoulders. And the total amount after my second graduate degree that I had in debt was literally a $1,000 personal loan.
Bert Fohr was a classmate of mine at Brandeis University, became a lawyer, founded the American Antitrust Institute.
When it came time to get jobs in college, the government was hiring and there were jobs in the government. And we had that advantage because of a growing economy, a booming economy, if you will.
Norma McKay from the Chicago suburbs, a retired software engineer.
I have 5 job offers without me doing any bit of work. I got offers from IBM, Bell Laboratories, Rockwell International, Sun Microsystems. I got to reject IBM. That was really something.
Allison Adderley, a 62-year-old community college professor in Orlando, Florida.
I bought my first house when I was 24.
How much did it cost?
$51,000.
That home has about tripled in value. By contrast,
you have to lower your expectation. It's not viable.
When we were their age, there was less inequality, homes were cheaper, the middle class stronger, taxes on the wealthy higher. Climate, outsourcing, offshoring, no issue. So did our panelists feel guilty about what's happened on our watch?
I want to apologize because I don't feel we're leaving a better world for them. I guess we shoulder all the blame, right? Because we're the people that were in charge.
I feel somewhat guilty, like we dropped the ball.
The other half of the panel, however, disagreed.
I don't feel guilty because I believe that it was just circumstance that put us at that time period. I do feel responsible. I don't feel guilty.
I don't buy this generational guilt at all. I think that we were lucky. We were on a ladder that was going up with no help from us. The ladder meant that things, assets, were increasing in value in ways that they are not today.
So you don't feel guilty about the tax cuts, the offshoring, the things that you think have put millennials at a disadvantage?
I've probably opposed all of those things during the last 40 years. So I don't feel guilty about it. I feel frustrated. I wanted to leave a better world for my kids and grandkids.
But boomers voted for the folks who pushed these policies, no?
Politically, you have a very diverse country, and people vote for any number of reasons at that particular point in time.
In fact, since the 1980s, boomers have by and large split about evenly in presidential elections. So about half of us voted for tax cuts and freer markets, half not. half our panel feels guilty, half not. And look, says Steinhorn,
economic change is often beyond the control of a generation because you're living through it. You're managing, you're trying to raise a family, you're trying to sort of support yourself. You're trying to put a roof over your head and food on the table and have a meaningful, if you can, livelihood in that matter.
Instead of feeling guilty, he argues that baby boomers have plenty to be proud of.
Fundamentally, the baby boom generation took on the outdated norms of the generation before and began to transform America.
Sure, the greatest generation survived the Depression, helped win World War II, but that's not their whole legacy, says Steinhorn.
They were the ones who chose to move into the Levittowns and exclude black people from those suburbs, who continued to deny the rights of women, to, you know, force gay people to go through implosive therapy or electroshock therapy because they didn't fit in. So the baby boom generation saw that and fundamentally changed it.
Civil rights, feminism, LGBTQ and disability rights. No panelist felt guilty about this history.
I am very proud. Yeah, you know, demonstrations on campus, peaceful demonstrations. I was there every day at lunchtime.
We may not have brought it to complete fruition, but we started a lot of it. I, as a baby boomer, I'm going to take some credit for that as I take some blame for the other stuff as well.
But what about the existential threat that millennials will face after we're long gone? Global warming.
Under baby boomers' watch, did this happen? Sure, but this is something that's been going on for 175 years since the dawn of the industrial era, and we are really fully realizing the consequences of all of that now. So to say that one generation is responsible for that, that's ahistorical.
And please don't forget, says Steinhorn,
it was the baby boom generation that basically motivated Earth Day and jump-started the environmental movement.
So then how valid is it to generalize about one generation at all?
You have to look at history as a far more complex phenomenon than the sort of generational divide that is really artificial is framing right now. So why are we pitting a generation against each other when in fact all they're basically doing is pointing a finger at baby boomers for a few bad mistakes that took place during those years, not recognizing how society has transformed since the 1950s in fundamental, deep, institutional, personal, interpersonal ways.
Bert Fuhr agreed.
You can't blame one generation because one generation never has power, at least not for much time.
Allison Adderley?
I agree. You cannot group any, whole group of people together and say that they all think alike.
But as a member of the generation that popularized the phrase, don't trust anyone over 30, there is one part of the millennial critique that Steinhorn applauds.
I think okay boomer is a great phrase. I think every younger generation should stick their thumb in the eye of their elders and poke them and prod them and basically say, okay, stop giving us your wisdom and stop telling us what to do. It's our turn now and we're going to do it.
Handing off the baton with some relief then. For the PBS NewsHour, Paul Solman.